Welcome to the Perry Lakes Basketball Stadium in Perth for the Women's National Basketball League Game of the Week. This time it's the AIS who have trekked across the Nullarbor to take on the Perth Lynx. I'm Darren Boyd for ABC Sport, and this should be an interesting game. While some teams in the competition are still fighting tooth and nail for playoff positions, unfortunately for these two teams, only pride remains. But as I welcome Laurie Chiswick, my co-commentator, Laurie, we know that pride can be often a great motivator.
It certainly can, Darren. Look, both of these teams are certainly going to be trying to get that win. In fact, whilst they've been few and far between, they've really challenged some of those top teams right down to the wire. And I think they'll be looking at this game as a way of evaluating their season, seeing if their defensive principles are in place, wanting to end on a winning note, and also perhaps looking towards the future. So I think both teams will be after that elusive W.
Well, I've got no doubt you're right, Laurie. And as we look at the ladder, it confirms that these teams in 7th and 8th position cannot make the finals. But the other six teams can, Laurie.
Well, that's certainly right, Darren. And I don't think that these two teams will actually play a role in determining who's in the top four or, in fact, who makes the playoffs. But you know what? If I was the Adelaide, Canberra, Sydney, Dandenong, Boleyn, whoever plays them in the next few weeks, I certainly wouldn't take them lightly. Either team are certainly capable of an upset.
Well, what do you think then are the keys to tonight's game?
Well, I think for the Institute, they really need to take advantage of their size. The last time we saw them on the ABC against Dandenong, they just didn't utilize those mismatches out there. Get the ball inside, make Perth collapse on their defense, and that opens it up for their perimeter shooters.
And how about for the Perth Lynx? Because there's no doubt that they play a completely different style of game.
Well, they do, Darren, and certainly the focus is on superstar Carly Wilson. I think the other players, however, knowing that she's going to be double-teamed and triple-teamed, really have to step up, really have to take some of the pressure off of her. The Angela Marinos, the Krista Hayes, Zoe Carr, it's their opportunity to step up. And I think both teams, again, are going to be chasing that hard tonight.
Well, thanks, Laurie. We'll let you go and get ready for tip-off, which is only a few moments away. But before the game, we actually caught up with Cayla Francis and one of the stars that Laurie was just talking about, Carly Wilson.
I think tonight it's going to be about defense and especially defensive transition. As you said, we've had a long season and it's been a tough one. We've only got two games left, so it's really important for us tonight to get the win and not only get the win but play well, you know, and then we've only got one game to go and hopefully we can secure that win as well against Dandenong.
Oh, well, it helps that my teammates around me support me really well and I feel that against Perth we have a lot more of a chance winning as, you know, they're not doing so well in the league as are we, so more of a chance of winning and just doing really well and competing better against the players that they have.
Well, thank you very much to Cayla and Carly. Now it's time to go over to the stats desk and check in with the man crunching all the important numbers, Mark Slocum.
Thanks, Darren. It's been particularly difficult to split these two teams in the stats, so I think it will come down to scoring in the end. Perth have managed to keep the AIS under their season average of 61 in both previous matches, and I think that their defence will again be the key to tonight's result.
Thanks, Mark. It will be interesting to see what role the D does play. And Eleanor Sharp down on the sidelines, what are your thoughts on tonight's game?
Although Perth and the AIS can't make finals this year, both teams will be desperate to get a win tonight. Perth and the AIS have both pushed some top teams so far this season. But tonight, AIS will really need to dominate the glass and contain Carly Wilson at the defensive end. Perth, however, will really need to dictate the defensive tempo of the game and perhaps press up the young AIS team and force some early turnovers.
Well, thank you very much, Eleanor Sharp. We're going to look at the starting fives for both teams straight off the top. And for the Perth Lynx in front of their home fans, we've got Angela Marino and Melissa Marsh starting in the backcourt, Carly Wilson, Krista Hayes and Zoe Carr.
It'd be really nice, Darren. Obviously, Wilson's a real focal point for Perth, and we expect that she's going to get between 15 and 20 points. But it'd be really good to see the likes of some of those other starters step up, really dominate, and like I said earlier, take the pressure off.
It'll be interesting to see who from the AIS is able to contain her. Starting for them, Katie Ebzery, Nicole Hunt, Rebecca Schatz, Cayla Francis, and Marianna Tolo.
And what a nice starting five that is. They've got a mixture of height, they've got the quicks in Hunt, they can shoot, they can go inside. The only thing they lack is experience.
And you mentioned in your package, in our package at the start of the game, Laurie, that the height is what the AIS need to focus on. And out on the court in that starting five, that's a key, it's an obvious sign for them.
Well, I think it is. And when you have something that's obvious, like your height, use it. Go to your strengths. Whilst they can shoot the outside perimeter shot, make that defense collapse, then it opens up and takes the pressure off.
Well, the Perth Lynx, they're just being introduced to their home fans. It's a hot night here at the Perry Lake Stadium in Perth. It's about 30 degrees today, but I think it might be about 35 in here, Laurie.
I don't reckon the players will notice it. They'll be out there fighting for it.
Well, let's just take a moment now to pause for the Australian National Anthem. It will be sung this evening by Kate Jemison from the WA Performance School. National anthem there, and on the end of that Perth Lynx line, Laurie, it's worth noting Emma Berryman, she's making her debut tonight.
Well, that's what a great game for her to make her debut. One game where they think that they can win this, and hopefully she'll get a bit of court time.
Well, the Perth Lynx, the AIS certainly share their court time around. It'll be interesting to see how the Perth Lynx do that. But one player who doesn't share much court time with anyone is Carly Wilson. She's Perth Lynx's go-to player, and she's second in the league for minutes played.
Well, she is, and she is their superstar, and we can see she does so much on the court. Interesting to note that we can see on the screen that she's averaged 18.6, but the last four games she's only been averaging 10 points. Now, that could be a product of teams double and triple teaming her, or maybe she's just, you know, tired from all the points she's scored so far, but she's certainly somebody that the AIS has to watch.
And down the other end, Cayla Francis has probably been the AIS MVP this season, and she's been super impressive.
Well, she has, and she's had consistent, in a young squad, a very consistent season. She's their leading scorer, their leading rebounder. She's second in the league for three-point shooting at 40%. She's in the gem squad. She's got it all in front of her, Cayla Francis.
And Laurie, as the coach, and you must think that the ability for her to do it at both ends is so encouraging in such a young player.
Well, it is, and she just has to build on it. You know, they learn so much at the Institute, and then they have to go out to a club and continue that hunt for things.
Well, one of the players who'll have the big job of minding Cayla and her running mate, Marianna Tolo, is Krista Hayes for the Perth Lynx.
Well, Krista averages 10 points a game and 9 rebounds. And her coach is really asking her to be a big target inside, finish, be strong on the boards. Again, she's been a consistent post player for them and shoots at 47%. So they're going to look for big things from her tonight.
And Marianna Tolo is the player, as I said a moment ago, she'll be up against for a large part. And she's a defensive specialist.
Well, she is. It's good to see her playing so well this season. She's third in the league in block shots. She's second in scoring for and rebounding for the Institute. And more importantly, she started every game in her debut season with the Institute.
It's an impressive record, and she's come from Mackay in Queensland. It's a long way and a new life in Canberra.
Well, it is, and she's obviously adjusted very well. She's in the gem squad, and again, her future is very bright.
Well, there she is, number 14. And the referees for tonight's game, Damien Lyons, Craig Hansen and David Cohen. So we're almost ready for a start. Round 15 of the Women's National Basketball League from Perry Lake Stadium in Perth. The 7th placed Lynx taking on the 8th placed AIS. The last time these two sides met, it was the Perth Lynx prevailing. They've won the last five against the AIS, but a lot of people giving the AIS a big chance here tonight.
Well, you know what, Darren, I think once that ball has been thrown up and that first jump's been taken, forget where they are on the ladder. Both teams could be playing for top spot right now.
Hayes with a safe early rebound. Point guard Angela Marino already under some pressure from Nicole Hunt. So Zoe Carr forced to bring the ball up. Going through some sets of hands. Zoe Carr, the outside shot. Oh, got the lucky bounce. That's the home court. The home court ring just there.
Well, that's a great way to start your first shot of the game.
Hunt inside to Tolo. Carr did well. Put enough pressure on Tolo's shot. Forced the error.
That was a good option for the Institute. A little screen and roll play. Nicole Hunt hitting Tolo on the roll.
Under 9 minutes remaining in the first quarter. Schatz, big job against Wilson. Here's Marsh. She didn't like it. She followed it in, but it was good enough.
Again, that was another good execution coming off a low screen, had her feet set nice and early, and came off ready to shoot the ball.
Francis. Another happy roll. If friendly rings,
they
shoot
are.
A shooter's rings.
That's good.
We could be seeing a high score, Laurie. You haven't seen your 100-point game so far this season. You barrack for it every week.
Well, I'm not sure if it'll come this game, but I'll take anyone. We only have three rounds to go. It's got to come soon.
Hayes putting the ball on the floor. Single numbers on the shot clock. Well executed again from the Lynx. Krista Hayes converting.
Well, you can't complain. A 3 for 3, 100% shooting at this stage of the game. Paul O'Brien would be happy with that.
Ebzery. Nice little turnaround jump shot, wouldn't fit. Hayes again on the boards. Marsh, great vision for Wilson. Tolo closed her down, but gave away the foul. Carly Wilson to shoot a pair. Well, Carly Wilson is the best free throw shooter in the competition. She's averaging 88% from the line, and we can see Tolo just forcing out. Didn't look like a lot of contact there. In fact, the foul was by Hunt. Mark Slocum's just pointed out to me.
And she keeps that average going. What a great average, 88%. And, you know, she's put up over 60 shots, so it's not like she doesn't go to the line very often.
And she might find herself at the line a lot tonight. The AIS foul the most out of any team in the competition, and their opponents can often win games almost from the charity stripe alone, Laurie.
Well, I think that's what happens when you have an inexperienced team is they perhaps don't get right in the correct defensive position, and you tend to foul that little bit more.
Here's Hunt for three. Nice start from her.
Both teams are playing with a lot of confidence. It's great to see.
7 minutes remaining in the opening quarter in Perth. The Lynx are leading by three. And they'll go through another patient offense.
AIS have gone straight into a zone that sort of really baffled Perth.
Well, Eleanor Sharp's on the sideline, and Eleanor, I know pre-match you were thinking that Perth might press, but perhaps it's the AIS that are throwing some different defences.
Yeah, they certainly are, Darren. I really am impressed with the way they've come out and really applied that pressure, caused a few turnovers and just put a bit of doubt in the minds of the Perth players. But they're a more experienced team, and I think they'll really settle the ship down, and especially players such as Carly Wilson. I don't think she'll take long to really find her feet and her offensive form.
6.5 minutes remaining. Perth Lynx leading it by three. Krista Haynes has three rebounds already. Francis, outlet to Ebzery. Manu made good position, but it's out to Hunt. Now Francis in a nice spot.
Good
great hustle. Oh, the AIS desperately unlucky there, Rebecca Schatz.
She'd be disappointed on missing that. She judged the rebound very well. The AIS look like they're going in a zone after a score and staying man-to-man on a miss.
First number six, the AIS. Melissa Marsh to inbound for the referee, Perth.
5 minutes 55 remaining in the opening quarter. Wilson almost lost control of the ball, and it showed on the shot. Great transition basketball from the AIS. Needed the score, though. Manu disappointed again. And the Perth Lynx make them pay.
Nice pass from Melissa Marsh. She waited until the defender had committed to her before she made that pass.
Ebzery shot. And will the Perth go into transition again?
The last couple of times down the floor, the Institute have taken fairly early shots in their offense. They're not really making Perth play much defense.
And they should have boxed out Krista Hayes. The Perth Lynx have another opportunity. The AIS coach, Dean Kinsman, looking very animated on the bench as Carly Wilson drives to the basket. The foul might be on Rebecca Schatz. It is. Coming in from behind.
You could see on that replay how Carly Wilson, as she was driving in, had her eyes on the target the whole way, wasn't looking at the defenders.
Well, with 4 minutes 54 remaining in the opening quarter, the first timeout called by the AIS. And we'll head into the huddle in a moment with Paul O'Brien and the Perth Lynx.
So we fight over here the first, make sure we get over the first, the second double. What I want to do is make sure, okay, that we'll switch that if we have to. We shouldn't need to, all right? So get over the first one, okay? Hard show from the post player, but remember they'll look to dive that, okay? So be aware. So if that second player is a post player there, they look to set that second screen. Make sure what we do is we make a hard show, okay? Actually, what we'll do is let's go underneath the bit. Go underneath. We'll fight over the first, go underneath the second. Let's make a really hard show. Yeah. Okay, let's go underneath the second one. Is that clear? Got that? So hard show, go underneath and bump. Let's go. 1, 2, 3. It's all about forwards, ladies. Keep it up.
Paul O'Brien saying it's all about boards, and at the moment, 8 rebounds to 4. The Perth Lynx, they'd be desperate to keep that statistic up, Lloyd.
Well, they would. That's a great stat for them. And it shows in their second chance opportunities.
So Carly Wilson stepping up to the foul line yet again. 100% so far in the match. 3-4-3. Last time against the AIS, she was kept a little bit quiet. Only had 16 points by her standards. That's a little bit quiet. The previous time she had 25, so she is capable of dominating games.
We can see that number 5, Kate Gaze, has come into the game.
4.5 minutes remaining in the opening quarter. It's Perth by 7. Hayes, turnaround jump shot. Missing. Kate Gaze is actually wearing Jamie Kennedy's shirt, so don't be confused at home. Rebecca Schatz all the way. Manu fighting hard for the offensive rebound. That was nice play. The AIS haven't had too many second looks, and Cayla Francis gives away the foul. Reaching over the top is...
Perth are fronting the posts inside and making it hard to make those feeds, and the Institute are turning that ball over on those feeds.
And a double substitution for the AIS. Emma Langford checking in, and Marianna Tolo, after a very short breather, back into the action. Here's Marino. She's been quiet so far. Driving hard to the basket and drawing the contact from Ali Manu. That's encouraging for the Lynx. Obviously, Carly Wilson is capable of winning the game almost by herself, but they do need to get players like Marino and Marsh involved offensively.
Well, so far, dribble penetration has been very successful for them. They're drawing the fouls and getting to the stripe, so that's something the Institute need to take care of.
Angela Marino, also a very good free throw shooter this season. free throw shooter, I should say, this season.
I think the Heat must be getting to us.
I think it could be. Tolo. That was Langford, in fact. Nice finish. Under 4 minutes remaining in the opening quarter. Institute trailing by 6 in Perth. They want to stay close. The first match, they're actually 0-2 against Perth this season. The first match, they were blown out. They trailed by 18 points at half time and were never in the contest.
They great assist, Carly Wilson. Play. Again, that dribble penetration, this time through the opposite defender and had great vision. Krista Hayes did a good job of going to the basket.
Gaze. Running the show now with Langford. Single numbers again, down to 4 seconds on the shot clock. Kate Gaze from Caitlin Ryan territory.
Well, look, she's known for her three-point shooting, for her shooting prowess, and she'll be happy with that, and so will her coach.
And the AIS now with some extended pressure. They've got the margin back to 5, under 3 minutes remaining in the opening quarter. Of course, you know a bit about Kate Gaze, Laura. You were assistant coach on a tour that she was on to New Zealand recently.
That's right, and while she's a shooter, we were trying to get her to develop other parts of her game, and that's certainly what being at the Institute is all about.
Langford, if it's good enough for Hunt and Gaze, she will try as well, and Emma Langford drains the bomb. The AIS staying in touch. And Marino straight to the... Poor defensive transition from the AIS.
Well, if you look at the stats, Perth haven't shot a 3 and the Institute have already put up 6 in this quarter.
Steal from Krista Hayes. Marino in the open court. Will she be able to finish? She does it nicely. 2 minutes remaining in the first quarter. Stripped of the ball. 7 seconds on the shot clock. Gaze again from deep.
Oh, that was halfway in. But you have to know she's a shooter. The clock's ticking down. You've got to carry a hand. Get out to that.
Working hard. Great play by Melinda Bartlett. A 10-point margin, double digits for the first time in the match, and that was a great finish from Bartlett. Manu setting the first pick. And rejected by Hayes. Now it is only 5 seconds. Again, the AIS under pressure. And again, Kate Gaze forced to fire from a long way out. Dean Kinsman, the coach, is on his feet. As we see Krista Hayes just throw that thing away.
Good execution of their out of bounds play.
Francis, nice finish. 53 seconds remaining in the first quarter, the margin back to 8. Marino, it looked a little bit careless with the dribbling. Survived. Nice pressure there from Hunt. Single numbers for Perth. Hayes got goal side of Francis. The AIS good enough for now. They'll settle it down. Francis again for 3. She's top 10 in the league from that distance, but that wasn't convincing. Now the AIS can settle it down with 18 seconds remaining for the last shot of the opening quarter.
We'll see if they have enough poise to just take that one shot and not give Perth an opportunity.
Francis in the high post, Tolo's down low. Carly Wilson almost stripped her of the basketball. Paul O'Brien a bit disappointed with the outcome there. And see Carly Wilson, oh, she just saw the ball and couldn't resist.
Tolo steps up the line for 2.
4 seconds remaining. Marianna Tolo to shoot the pair. She's only shooting the ball at 59% from the free throw line. So she'll need to improve that across the course of her career. At least she made the back end. Marino, she's got a history of making buzzer beaters. but she wasn't aware of the time, obviously, because didn't even attempt the shot, Angela Marino. But at quarter time, the home fans in Perth will be happy as the Lynx lead the AIS by 7. Well, Laurie, an entertaining opening quarter. The Perth Lynx able to get off to a fast start in front of their home fans.
Well, I liked where the tempo that both teams were playing. They both looked desperate out there. They were after it hard. They were shooting the ball with confidence, good intensity, good tempo. It was a good first quarter.
Well, Laurie, interesting that you talk about the AIS. Your main point was that they had to go inside, but there's this been a perimeter-orientated game again.
Well, it is, and I think they need to mix that up, because it's okay if you're hitting those shots, but if you go through a dry spell, you need to have another option out there. So I'd like to see them mixing it up a little bit more, really get inside and seal and post and be a target.
And offensively, they've actually got a few offensive rebounds late in that quarter, which has enabled them some second shots, but they still haven't really been looking inside.
Well, I like the way both teams are going after the offensive rebound. Krista Hayes got a really important one for Perth. Melissa Marsh was following her shot, even though it went in, which is important. So, you know, if you can come up with some second chance points and shots, it's a good thing for your team.
Well, the Perth Lynx there. All just being addressed by Paul O'Brien, their coach, and now we're going to be addressed by Mark Slocum. What's on the stat sheet, Mark?
Thank you, Darren. 64% from the Lynx there, from the field. That stands out. The AIS, 29%. Can improve a little bit on that. The three-pointers, as you mentioned earlier, Perth have yet to have a long-range shot, which is very unusual. And free throw spot, they got there 6 times. And the AIS only 1 set to Tolo. Rebounds 11-9, evened up in that later in that quarter.
Well, thanks, Mark. Now down to the sideline. Eleanor Sharp, what's news in the huddles?
Well, Darren, not much to report from those huddles, but I agree with Laurie that the AIS really need to look to go inside. They've got such great size and mismatches against Perth and can really utilise that down the offensive end. Defensively for the AIS, I think they really need to contain the drivers. They've been beaten to the middle, which is a no-no in basketball in the quarter court. So really ball pressure, but also contain those drivers and force them baseline.
Second quarter in Perth at Perry Lake Stadium. It's the Perth Lynx leading by 7. And Jasmine Finnegan will get us underway. Melissa Marsh running the point while Angela Marino has a rest for the Lynx. Melissa Marsh has developed her all-court game this season. She's disappointed with that play, Laurie. We might come back to that, but will Perth get it back? They will.
They're lucky there. Carly started to do a curl cut and then pulled out, and they just didn't have that eye contact, and Marsh made that pass. Fortunately for Perth, they got it back at the other end.
But Melissa Marsh has really developed this year and is a really important player for the Perth Lynx now.
Well, she is. She plays an important role. She's good anticipation.
And a great finish. Melinda Bartlett. The AIS immediately under pressure in the second quarter. Here's Newley for her first points of the night. Mia Newley with the three-point bomb, but it was preceded by this steal by Melinda Bartlett and the nice finish. 9 minutes remaining in the second quarter and the Perth Lynx leading it by 6. Here's Wilson. Finnegan had to get the ball up. Now Hunt, great pass into Tolo.
Great vision
finish
by Nicole Hunt. That's good running the floor by Tolo. Right down to the point of the rim too. She didn't run to the block, she ran right straight to the point of the rim, and it was good vision.
The AIS have scored the last 5, which is important because they were trailing by 10 in that first quarter. Langford with a tough job against Wilson. Hayes, nice rebound. Tolo couldn't worry her out of the point. It's a great finish by Krista Hayes.
Well, that's what her coach, Paul O'Brien, is looking to get out of her. Get those rebounds, those second opportunities, and finish strongly.
Langford. 7 points for Emma Langford. An impressive start from her. Newley guarding Marsh. Finnegan playing a bit of inside outside with Wilson for three.
First three-pointer of the game for Perth.
At only their second attempt. So 50% from beyond the arc. The AIS are 4 for 10. They're not shy. There's Hayes. After the ball was turned over by Hunt. It was 1-on-2. She almost finished the layup. Somehow Perth got the rebound.
For three, not this time.
And Finnegan showed more desperation than Yuli.
That was great. I just happened to be watching her, and she came from half court as that shot was being made and came up with the offensive glass.
Well, that's one of the reasons why she's one of the co-captains of Perth, Laurie, I think. Only in her first season in the WNBL side. But they're under pressure now. 4 seconds on the shot clock. Carly Wilson threw up an absolute prayer in the end. The AIS trying to force the ball up the floor. Tolo is caught out of position inside. And again, there's a turnover.
I like the way Nicole Hunt is pushing the ball up the floor and having a look and seeing what's ahead of her.
Well, she's turned the ball over a couple of times, but she's certainly playing an up-tempo style of game. Oh, Wilson, great finish.
Nice finish, Carly Wilson.
That's all class, that sort of finish. Curling around, getting the ball in continuation of the cut strong to the basket.
Wilson with 9 points. 6 minutes remaining in the second quarter in Perth. Carla Francis couldn't finish close to the basket. As we see Carly Wilson on that last play, it was a beautiful finish. And Emma Langford left sprawling.
Good
great
flare.
Screen from Krista Hayes allowed Carly Wilson.
Carly recognized that her defense slid high side and she flared to that low spot. Great read on Carly's behalf.
The Lynx have scored the last 7 to lead by 11. Francis couldn't finish the hour. Yes, still shooting the ball at under 40%. The AIS, the Perth Lynx are up above 50. Five minutes remaining in the opening quarter. Finnegan driving to the basket. Tolo did well. It has to go up. That wasn't a shot. The shot wasn't registered on the last play because, of course, it didn't touch the ring. It was a blocked shot.
That's right. So they needed to, the shot clock continued ticking down and there wasn't that recognition.
So a timeout has been called by Dean Kingsman of the AIS. His charges are trailing by 11, 4 minutes 45 remaining in the second. Well, Dean Kingsman addressing his team and we'll head into that huddle right now.
Throw it through sets of hands and break them down. Just too many second efforts they're coming up with down this end. Defensively now, as we said, if we score, come up 41 with this group. If we don't score, 21s and 32s. Know where we are. Okay, 32 this time. Now on 32, be aware of the shooter, but we've got to make sure we secure the board. We don't go away from our running game when we secure the defensive rebound. We want to challenge that. The big, run the split line and get on the basket. Okay, hey, next time down. Go a special four, but you've got to work to stay out in front of the basket. Give yourself room to play. We've had two good post-ups.
Well, Dean Kingsman calling a couple of specific plays, it seemed, Laurie.
Well, I'm not sure. I don't know, but I would think special four might be for an isolation play for Cayla Francis inside. We'll see.
Cayla Francis inbounds the ball for the AIS. 4 minutes 45 remaining in the second quarter. They trail by 11. Francis makes position inside. Well, you can see why she was WNBL Coach of the Year.
She did a good job of starting high and demanding the ball, getting her defense in a certain position and really sealing her, and the pass was a good pass to her.
Wilson for three.
There you go.
14 points for Carly Wilson.
She's come alive this quarter.
Well, Eleanor, you're in the Perth huddle at that last time out. Was the three-point play for Carly Wilson the choice?
Well, it was special Carly, so I think I think it was. The message from Paul O'Brien, Darren, was just continue with their offensive structure and get ball reversals. So keep working the AIS girls and make them rotate, and that way it'll continue to get looks. But I think, as you can see, Carly's really starting to feel it, so she's the person that they want to get the ball into her hands.
Finnegan, Wilson down low. Carr now making position. Perth leading by 12. Single numbers on the shot clock. Zoe Carr, nice play. And the Perth Lynx have got the last five.
I like the way Perth are executing and playing with a lot of poise, getting it through hands, making the Institute play some defense, where conversely the Institute probably could work it around a little bit more. If you don't have that initial transition shot, then get through your offensive structure.
Marino rejected by Francis. Ebzery, great catch. The pass was a little bit behind as you had to be athletic.
It was good to see Francis dribbling that ball up the floor with a lot of confidence.
He was not bad for 192 centimeters, just
exactly.
Driving down the court.
Usually as a coach you cringe and think, oh, give it to a guard.
Here's Wilson. Didn't finish. Francis shoved by Finnegan, and she will win the ball from the end. You see, there's Yasmin Finnegan just barreled her over. Cayla Francis. Well, she travelled, I think, expecting that the whistle would come. It's a dangerous game to play. 2.5 minutes remaining in the second quarter. The Perth Lynx leading it at home by 12. And Cayla Francis just sat down, and Tolo back in the game. Here's Schatz for three. Entry, nice offensive rebound. Allows the AIS to reset. Tolo, she was open for a split second inside. The ball went in, and she'll have a chance for the three-point play.
Good inside look, and good finish by Marianna Tolo.
Well, she's had a great debut season, Marianna Tolo. She will certainly go close to winning the Betty Watson Rookie of the Year award, as a timeout has been called by the Perth Lynx. With 2 minutes and 7 seconds remaining, they lead it by 10. Well, Marianna Tolo will step up and shoot free throws. She'll probably just be getting a little bit nervous as she's waiting. She's not the best from the free throw line, as we saw earlier in the game. But Paul O'Brien of Perth is addressing his troops at the moment. And we might pop in and hear what he has to say.
Because on that curl, we're getting good penetration. Likewise, special. Make sure special goes in there as well. Particularly, dribble penetration on 23 and special is excellent. We're coming off those screens hard. We're getting high percentage shots. We must continue to crash the boards, though. Big rewards for crashing the boards here, OK? That's the first thing. Secondly, defensively, let's make sure that if they're running baseline players on screens, they're long screens, they're going to be communicating. We've got to lock and trail and run harder. We do not give up this now. And every block out, that was it. They've got a three-point play here. We've got to block out. One, two, three. Every block out.
Well, Laurie, Paul O'Brien really focusing on rebounding tonight.
Well, he was very animated in that timeout, very specific in what he wanted, and recognizing that if you can win it on the boards, you can get your running game going, you can prevent them from having second shots. So he was really emphasizing that blocking out.
Well, Tolo steps up to the line, only one shot. She's averaging 8 points and five rebounds this season, and third in the league in block shots. It's impressive stats. She stands 196 centimeters. So she's an intimidating presence under the basket, that's for sure.
We see the Institute has extended out their defense and was going full court.
Marsh, run out of options. Hayes for a two-point basket. Was it hairball?
Not a good option, not a good shot choice there.
Just under 2 minutes remaining in the second quarter. AIS trailing by nine at the moment. ambitious pass from Martin Manu somehow came up with the basketball. As Melissa Marsh is hurt behind play. And the referees called a halt to proceedings. They felt that Melissa Marsh might be in a little bit more trouble if she was bowled over. She looks to be okay. We'll see her just collected fairly heavily by Ellie Manu. She's from country WA. I'm sure she's a pretty tough character.
It's interesting. We have that call where the referee stopped the game in this instance.
Didn't happen last week.
No, that's right. Now, whether it was at this end of the court and there's a chance that somebody, you know, a danger factor.
Common sense, I think, prevailed this time. Here's Ebzery. Nice pick and roll with Manu, but she couldn't finish. Marino, nice anticipation. 65 seconds remaining in the second quarter. A couple of opportunities for the Perth Lynx. Here's Marino. Now Wilson, she's been shooting well from the perimeter. Passed up that option. Gave it into Marsh. Zoe Carr was always going to out-rebound Katie Ebzery. That was a bad mismatch inside. But the Lynx still found a way to turn the ball over. The skip pass going awry.
Well, even if you can get a finger to the ball and redirect it, we talk about deflections and getting your hand in the passing lane. You don't have to always flat out steal it, but if you can just get a deflection, that can be a real positive.
Ebzery, nice feed into Tolo and a great finish.
That's good. I like what Tolo's doing in there. She's getting position. While she's missed a few, she's doing all the right things.
She's got 8 points at a high percentage at the moment, to 75%. She's doing quite well as Schatz ran into a heavy screen, but the foul had already been called. She was just caught up. Just caught up, Angela Marino there. Perth with the ball from the side with only 10 seconds remaining.
See what their last gasp shot is.
Marino straight to the basket. Great finish. 4 seconds remaining. Now three. The AIS will have to be quick. Tolo needs to go. Won't count. So at halftime, the Perth Lynx have extended their quarter time lead by 2 points. They now led it by 9. It's the Perth Lynx 41, the AIS 32. Well, welcome back to the Perry Lake Stadium in Perth, where the home side of the Perth Lynx are putting on a good show for their home fans, and they led it by 9 points at halftime, 41 points to 32. Laurie Chiswick, what's impressed you most about the first half?
Well, to be honest, I like the intensity that both teams came out at. Even we talked about, even though they're bottom of the ladder, they have a lot to win in this and a lot to go for. So their intensity, the tempo that they played with the Institute, I like the way they mixed up their defenses a little bit. And we could see in the second quarter, they did go inside.
And Carly Wilson for the Perth Lynx has been most impressive. She started this game on fire.
Well, look, I like the way she was doing it. She was doing dribble penetration early on, then got hot from the perimeter and nailed a couple of three-pointers. Defensively, she's been fronting. She's getting her hand to the ball. As we expected, she's doing a great job.
And we see in the highlights, this is a great three-point bomb from the AIS, but a couple of loose turnovers has created some easy opportunities for the Perth Lynx.
Well, I guess we expect that from the Institute, given that they're young and inexperienced and they're trying some things. But, you know, that's an area they'll have to work on. I don't think it's been too bad, and I think in the second quarter they improved on it.
Well, Laurie, with the game plan of the AIS, I mean, you spoke before the game about their need to go inside, but they really haven't. I mean, do you think that Dean Kinsman is instructing them to stay on the perimeter?
Well, I think, you know, they look like they run a four-out, one-in motion, so they do take a lot of perimeter shots. But I thought Tolo did a good job, as we can just see, or Francis, of getting that ball inside in the second quarter and maybe releasing the pressure a little bit on their outside shooters.
And they needed to, really, because they were trailing in from the field goal percentage perspective, was 64% to 29%. At quarter time, so they had to do something about that. Mark Slocum, I wonder whether they actually did.
Well, we'll have a look at that now, Darren, because the stats page for Perth there. Wilson has 14 points, leading the way on 4 of 9 shooting. Perfect 4 from 4 from the free throw line. For me, the standout in the first half was Hayes. 8 points and 8 rebounds. Did a very good job for the Lynx, especially in the first quarter. Had a bit of time off in the second because of the heat. For the AIS, Langford had 7 points. Tolo's their leading scorer with 8, had 7 in the second quarter. They went 7 of 12 in that second quarter, so they actually shot better from the field, but those turnovers that you mentioned before got them in a bit of trouble. Field goal percent, Perth down to 50%, AIS up to 38, rebounds 18 to 20, very even. Perth winning that quarter 18 to 16, and this is the first game they've won, the first term and the second term, since they beat the AIS in round 3.
Well, thank you very much, Mark. Some interesting stats.
Free throw shooting. Very important facet of the game as we start the third quarter action. The AIS with the control of the basketball. They trail by 9. Ebzery and Hunt. Both teams reverting back to their starting fives. Tolo, ball was wrestled from her by Carr. That was desperation shown.
Well, it's always interesting to see which team comes out at halftime and who's been motivated by their coach's talk or who can settle earliest.
Here's Hunt. Schatz was running for her, but she decides to go herself and desperately unlucky in the end that she didn't get the ball back. I thought it might have come off a Perth
hand.
Well,
I thought it did too, actually.
Lost control of it, and maybe it didn't come off a Perth hand. The referee was in good position. So too was Eleanor Sharp. Eleanor, that happened right in front of you, but not sure if you disagree, and what else do you have to report?
I thought that Nicole Hunt had her foot on the line, actually, Darren. So I'm really not sure about that call. Darren, at halftime, it's, you know, the Perth girls really came bouncing out of that change room and really looked to be the team that was enthused. And they definitely dictated the first half in terms of the tempo of the game, and offensively they executed well. So I think the AIS really need to step up their defensive intensity and put a bit of pressure on and particularly lock down Carly Wilson. And then down at the offensive end, as we saw towards the second quarter, the end of the second quarter, I think the AIS really need to go inside. Marianna Tolo made some great position and got some good feeds inside and connected on them.
Well, the Perth Lynx, they've been able to keep the AIS at arm's length since about halfway through the first quarter.
It's that 9-point margin as a coach that's never comfortable. You've got that lead, but you know it only takes 1 3-pointer, and it's a back to a 6-point game, which is anybody's. And when you're 9 points down, you really still have a sniff of it.
Carly Wilson rock solid from the free throw line. She's 5 for 5 tonight, leading the league in free throw shooting. And field goal stats aren't bad either for somebody that takes as many shots as she does, and particularly when they're under such pressure. So the Lynx back out to 11, 8.5 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Hunt driving, oh, almost a 3-point play. Angela Marino can't quite believe that the foul's been called in the end.
Nicole Hunt did a good job of taking that handoff and just, you can see her drop her inside shoulder into Marino. So she's initiated the contact, has that control, and draws a foul from that. That was a good play by her.
Well, Laurie, as Nicole Hunt lines up, we should bring our viewers up to date with the scores from elsewhere in the country. Up in Townsville, a very important game between the Townsville Fire and the Adelaide Lightning, and the Fire lead it at halftime by 2, 48-46.
What an amazing game that would be to be witnessing right now. It's a crucial game for both teams. It's obviously close. We know Townsville, it will be packed to the rafters.
And a great steal from Hunters. Langford running the lanes beautifully and a nice finish. We've come all the way to Perth and we've seen some good entertainment as Hunt, with the help D, stripped the ball away, and Emma Langford with the comfortable finish.
Well, I really like what Nicole Hunt's doing. I suppose I'm taking a little bit of extra interest in her as she'll be suiting up for the Victorian under 20 state team, which takes place at the end of the WNBL season in Ballarat.
And you'll be assistant coach of that team, Laura?
I will be. Looking forward to it.
Absolutely.
Actually, there's a few players on the court right now that'll be at that championship.
Who are a couple of the others?
Well, from the Institute, there's Rebecca Schatz and Tolo, Newley. Most of them will return to their state to play for their under 20 team.
So 7.5 minutes remaining in the third quarter. As Hunt fires for three, it's the AIS trailing by 9 and almost. Well, the Perth bench screaming for a foul. Hunt rejected by Carr. But Schatz is desperate and she dived on the loose ball.
Good second effort by the Institute. They're really going after it hard. It's an interesting battle going on between Marino and Hunt.
Hayes found herself in great position. Was able to get the offensive rebound and finish nicely for the Lynx, re-establishing that 9-point lead, the awkward 9-point lead as Laura described. Francis under all sorts of pressure inside. Great D from Wilson and Carr. But Wilson's pass a little bit ambitious.
Perth have actually done a good job of taking care of the ball. They only have 6 turnovers at this stage.
The AIS have 10. Francis monstered over the back by Hayes. She can't quite believe it, but from our perspective, it was a clear foul coming over the top as we see the replay.
Well, again, really good positioning on Cayla Francis's part. And I think the Institute are looking inside more. The bigs seem to be really working at being a target. On a ball reversal, they're sealing. And the guards are having a look at them inside.
So Cayla Francis, like Marianna Tolo, the other big player for the AIS, she can probably do with some improvement on her free throw shooting as her career goes forward, but 2 for 2 that trip up. She won't be disappointed as she has a rest. And Martin checks into the ball game. So 6.5 minutes remaining, the Perth Lynx leading it by 7 on their home court. Here's Marsh. She's been quiet offensively, only 6 points. 4 seconds on the shot clock. Hayes has called for the 3-second violation.
I just noticed when Carly Wilson passed it inside to Krista Hayes, 4 Perth players had their feet outside the 3-point line. None of them cut to the basket, none of them slashed, none of them moved really. If they're going to make a post feed, you have to make sure you move off of that.
Gaze under some pressure. The AIS do seem composed in this second half. Schatz, nice move. Beautiful little left-hand finish. Her first points for the night. The AIS have got the last 2 baskets. A stop here would be really important, you feel. I think it's coming to one of those important periods of the game, Laurie.
Well, Perth need a steadying basket because I'd have to say that the Institute has the momentum right now. Things seem to be going their way. Perth just look a little bit frustrated. They just need to relax. Good timeout by Paul O'Brien.
Well, Paul O'Brien has called this timeout. 5 minutes, 35 seconds remaining. And his side are leading it by 5 at home. So we'll check in with Paul O'Brien and the Perth Lynx just to hear exactly what his instructions will be at this important time.
Forward lead, hook in, flare out, got it? I need him down lower. So let's make sure there's free throw line extended. I want our catchers below free throw. Pinch in hard, make it offend you, maybe look for the seal, then release out sharp. Is that clear? Got that? Make sure we've got that release. Okay? Then from our offense, let's work our screening sets. If it's special, the screen's coming down. Okay? What we've got to do is, what they've done to us is they've penetrated. They've looked to penetrate. Good. Okay, we've got to lock down defensively, but we've got to do the same thing offensively. Hey, 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 get through stuff, and when a chance goes to a lane hard, let's hit it. One, two, three.
So the team's returning to the court. 5 minutes, 35 remaining in the third, and the Perth Lynx under some pressure, some sustained pressure from the AIS. 5 points the margin. Francis inside, there's Special K again, Laurie. 3 points.
Okay, Francis, your double figures. First, I'll tell you, I'm 10.
Cayla Francis with 10 points, Tolo with 10 points, Langford with 9. And they're three of their better inside players. Certainly Francis and Tolo are the major targets as Perth see single numbers again on the shot clock. Hayes under all sorts of pressure. Francis, the ball just evading her large reach. Well, Eleanor Sharp's on the sidelines. And Eleanor, how was Paul? How were the AIS at the timeout? Might check in.
Really listening closely in, and Dean was instructing the girls to play the double-double, which is obviously their inside offensive way, and also to just remain composed. And obviously, Perth are really trying to get up in their face and really causing some hassles, but just remain composed, which is a big ask for a young group.
And unfortunately, they turned the ball over. They've scored the last 6 points to drag this margin back.
Well, Perth talked in the timeout about executing their offense, getting it through hands, changing sides. And I know Paul O'Brien is really big on their spacing.
5 seconds on the shot clock. Now Trey Melissa Marsh with the big basket. With 4 minutes remaining.
That was one they very much needed.
Play.
Oh, good answer by Schatz.
So 3 minutes 45 remaining, the margin's at 4. Rebecca Schatz with the catch and shoot early on the last possession for the AIS. And Perth, I think the wind will be out of their sails a little bit because Marsh's big basket was important. But the AIS having that ability to answer. And Kate Gaze looks very composed on the ball, Laurie. Here's Francis.
Well, nice, they're getting hurt inside right now. They've got to start fronting those big girls or just keep going them to as far as the Institute. That's where they've scored their last 6 or 8 points.
And that's what you were talking about right from the outset. The Institute had to go inside to win this ball game. And there's a foul called on Cayla Francis, and she's very disappointed with that.
I'm not sure whether they've been letting a lot go tonight, and to me it looked a little bit like a no call. There we can see that pass inside and a good strong finish.
Cayla Francis has a rest. She's got 2 fouls, but she's got 12 points and 10 rebounds as well. She had a really good series of games against the Perth Lynx as Carly Wilson goes strong and Martin called for the foul.
Carly Wilson got that ball in the high post, and as soon as it touched her finger, she had it on the floor on a spin move and taking it strongly to the basket, drawing that foul.
So Carly Wilson, a perfect 6 for 6 from the foul line tonight. 16 points to be the leading scorer on court. That's just on her season average. Now it is. She's averaging 16.8 points this season. Good enough for 6th best in the competition. Substitution call for Perth. Bartlett checking in for Marino. 2 minutes 50 remaining in the third quarter. And Perth in front of their home fans at Perry Lake Stadium leading by 4. They led by 9 at half time and as much as 11 in this quarter. Martin, not quite. Wilson looks up and sees four AIS defenders ahead of her, so she's got no choice but to pull the ball up. And Finnegan couldn't get it to go. Langford quickly up the floor. Tolo was making position inside, but great defense there from the Lynx to force another turnover. 12 now to the AIS and only 7 for the Lynx. That could be an important stat. 2 minutes remaining in the third quarter. The Lynx still leading by 4. 5 seconds on the shot clock for the Lynx. Bartlett drew the foul. Probably, I can't imagine Dean Kinsman will be too happy with Nicole Hunt giving away that foul. They were in some trouble, the Perth Lynx, and Bartlett. Well, I didn't think that Bartlett was actually looking at the basket, but
she's going to the foul line.
She
saw that Carly Wilson actually had Hunt on her and was recognizing the mismatch. But she really did. They got out of jail on that one.
Linda Bartlett. A jump shot from the free throw line. You don't see that often. With a minute 50 remaining in the third, though, the Perth Lynx re-established a 6-point buffer. Here's Martin. She spent some time guarding Carly Wilson, which is certainly a tough ask. Here's Tolo, nice finish. She had plenty of time, Marianna Tolo, and she's up to 12 points to join Cayla Francis as the leading scorers for the AIS. Oh, Wilson grabbing her own rebound. Hunt zipping around her ankles, almost came up with a steal. But Perth can reset. 14 seconds on the shot clock for Melissa Marsh.
Wilson just turning the ball over.
And another one for the AIS at a crucial time. And Marsh capitalizes. Here's Nicole Hunt. We saw her on that last play just darting around, desperately throwing a hand, trying to come up with a steal. Instead, all the AIS could come up with was another turnover. And the Lynx still have that 6-point buffer. It's handy at this stage in the game.
They'd want a basket here to end the quarter and get back out to that 8 or 9 point margin.
Well, only 20 seconds remaining as Carly Wilson drains that basket. 16 seconds now as Nicole Hunt takes the inbound pass. Now 10. The AIS looking for something special off this last play. 4 seconds. Hunt will need to go herself for 3. Well, the AIS made some slight headway in that third quarter. They threatened to take the lead at 1 point, but instead they only made up 1 point and they trailed by 8 at three-quarter time. 60 points to 52. Well, Laurie, I really thought that the AIS were in with a big chance, but Mark Slocum, on the stat sheet, what did you make of it?
Well, that's right. You got it right there. 1 point they made up. Perth 19, AIS 20 that quarter. We look at the match stats. 48 shots from each team up to this stage. So that shows how even it is. Perth just getting to the free throw line 14 times to 7. That's where they have their advantage. Nothing in the rebounds. And a few more turnovers for the AIS. We're in for a good last quarter.
Thanks, Mark. That we certainly are. And sharing it with us will be Eleanor Sharp on the sidelines. And at the moment, Eleanor, you've got a special guest with you.
Yes, Darren, I have Gabby Richards. Gabby is a noticeable absentee from the Defence Jobs WNBL this season. Gabby's been away at the University of Oregon for 2.5 years. Gabby, welcome back. How was your experience at college?
Yeah, it was wonderful. It was so exciting. And especially to have Phil Brown come over for my second year, it was just great to have a familiar face and all of his knowledge at the college. So it was really good.
And now that you're back here in Australia, you've had an injury with your Achilles, but you're back here rehabbing, and I hear that you're hoping to get back into the Defence Jobs WNBL next season.
Yeah, definitely. I'm really excited to be hopefully out here on court next season. And yeah, rehab's going really well and really excited to get back into it.
Fantastic. Well, it's great to have you back, and good luck for whatever happens next season.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much to Eleanor Sharp and Gabrielle Richards, of course, spent some time at the AIS before going over to the United States to develop her basketball career. Well, Laurie, this game, 8 points of difference. Who's going to win?
Well, you know, Darren, it felt like the AIS had made a lot more inroads than just the 1 point. I felt that they really dominated that quarter, and it was just a couple of, you know, late baskets at Perth that brought it back out to that 8 point margin. So it'll be interesting to see if they can keep that intensity up.
The quarter by quarter scores, we see what Laurie was just talking about. The AIS winning that third quarter by one, but the Perth Lynx had established enough of a lead in the opening term that they still led it by eight. So with the fourth quarter about to start, the Perth Lynx at home at Perry Lake Stadium. 60 points to 52 they lead. And a three-quarter time up in Townsville, Laurie. The Townsville Fire doing everything that they can to try and sneak into the top four. They lead the Adelaide Lightning 72 points to 65.
Well, they need to win every game that they play for the rest of the season, Townsville. Adelaide obviously are still trying to hunt out that top spot or top two spots, so it'll be interesting. We should have an end of score before the end of our telecast.
Yes, looking forward to it. Exciting game up in Townsville, but also an exciting one here is Marsh fighting after the loose ball, but Manu was in best position. So 9.5 minutes remaining in the final term. Can the AIS continue their sustained run that they had in the third quarter and challenge the Perth Lynx? Francis backing out of the three-point line. It looked like one of my three-point shots from before the game.
In the commentator shootout.
Way over the basket. It wasn't much of a shootout. Eleanor Sharp was very impressive, it's fair to say. Maybe she might have to come and play with one of your teams, Laurie. As Manu was beaten for the rebound by Hayes. That's a really important offensive rebound for the Perth Lynx.
Oh, good steal, good hands.
And Hunt, she was tackled in the end by Marsh, and good foul for the Lynx because the AIS were away and the Perth Lynx don't have any foul trouble at all, so it was enough to stem their momentum. As
Hunt's been very tenacious out there, as we can see by that, again, that deflection forcing a turnover.
Schatz with plenty of time and plenty of room. She'd be disappointed she didn't make that jump shot. Neither side has scored as yet in this final term. 8 minutes remaining. Wilson, she'll stem the flow for three, according to the referee.
Her toe was very close to that line. She just stepped back a fraction to make that a three-point shot.
Oh, it must have been my last glimpse was with her toe in front of the line because I thought it was only a two-point basket. But the referee, as always, was in good position. And the Perth Lynx re-establishing that double-figure margin, and this is danger signs for the AIS.
You can see probably one of the weaknesses of the Institute's game right now, and I think it's just the nature of the youth that they've got, is that mid-range jump shot. Tend to be working on their three-point shots and perhaps that drive to the basket. And right now, that mid-range jump shot isn't quite where it eventually will be.
Hunt for three. She made one in the first quarter, but has come up empty since then.
Perth did a good job of blocking out on that last play.
7 minutes remaining in the match. Perth leading by 11. Melissa Marsh has controlled the tempo. She's got 11 points and a couple of assists. 3 points on the shot clock for Carly Wilson. Somehow she got right down to the basket. And Dean Kinsman wants to talk it over as he discusses with the referee the merits of Carly Wilson's last play.
Well, look, you can't, you wouldn't want the ball in anybody's hands other than Carly Wilson as that clock's ticking down.
Well, it's a Perth Lynx score the last nine. Dean Kinsman, I'm sure, has plenty to talk about.
When we come back out here,
goes special if the five man is open and they're being defended from behind, throw it in. If they're fronted, hard off this double screen, throw it. Five man, you wrap under. So spin and come under. Then goes special four. So we're going power plays inside. Next two plays.
Okay.
Hey, there's plenty of time in here. We need to bunch two or three stops together. Then keep running out of the backcourt. When we run out of the backcourt, decisions to be made. Have I got a dribble or have I got a pass or kick ahead? The big girls, you've got to run the split line for me there, because you get there, you'll get on the end of stuff. They will tire here if we keep momentum going. Come on, here, let's go.
Thank you, girls, the WA Performance School.
Let's
go, let's
go. Well, Dean Kinsman still encouraging his charges. They trail by 13. It is the biggest margin of the game. The Perth Lynx have scored the last nine, so worrying signs for the AIS with 6 minutes 50 remaining in the match. Here's Ebzery, she's been quiet tonight. Only 2 points, but Cayla Francis is doing very well. 14 points from her. Eleanor Sharp, you had a good look at the last play and also were listening into Paul O'Brien's last timeout for the Lynx. What's news?
Well, Darren, Paul's message to the girls was keep up the defensive intensity without getting any cheap fouls. So really, ball pressure, forcing the AIS girls to take those long shots, which they're not connecting on at the moment, but also not allowing the easy pass inside, so lots of ball pressure.
Well, plenty of pressure here for the AIS. Trailing by 13. Nice pass from Francis. Tolo was open.
They're doing a really good job, that combination, Francis and Tolo. They've got some high-low action. They're looking for each other.
Well, you suspect, Laurie, they'll have at least one more season at the AIS together to develop their games, and they're a pretty powerful pair. Both have 14 points tonight. Cayla Francis, double figures in terms of rebounds. She's got 10 as well.
Well, and they'll only get better and better. You know, they've got so much to learn and so much to experience just in understanding the game. And as we saw at halftime, what a great environment to do that in at the Institute.
Carly Wilson up to 27 points. She's been fantastic. Francis straight to the basket. Great play from her. She's leading this team. She's trying to lead this team. The margin's at 11. 5 minutes remaining in the match. And here's Langford putting pressure on Wilson. 5 seconds on the shot clock. Marino, tough shot. Never looked likely, but great hustle from Angela Marino. Enabled the spillage, and it got to Carly Wilson, so the Lynx have another opportunity. Where will Langford go? And an offensive foul is called on Bartlett. That was off the ball, Laurie. I think it was some an illegal screen or some pushing.
Yeah, I was watching the on-ball screen with Carly Wilson just to see how the Institute were defending it, so I missed that. Missed that foul.
4 minutes 45 remaining in the match. Perth 69, the AIS 58. Close game at the Perry Lake Stadium in Perth. Up in Townsville, it's the Fire leading by 7. Townsville Fire 72 and Adelaide 65. A really important game. Well, Laurie, up in Perth, it's a critical, up in Townsville, I should say, critical game, and the Flyers obviously doing a lot right. They're desperate to try and get one of those final spots in the playoff race, and they will need to continue to win. As we're being held up here a moment, I should say, because the score bench, there's a dispute over the score, and I think the score that's displayed is actually incorrect.
Well, in regards to Townsville, really, you think Townsville, Boleyn, Dandenong are all playing finals games this weekend, basically, because they need to win them to stay in that fourth spot.
Yeah, they certainly do. Eleanor Sharp, you're over on the sidelines. Your old team, the Canberra Capitals, also caught in that battle for the playoffs. But right now you're in the thick of the action trying to work out what's happening with this score bench.
Darren, apparently the score's supposed to be 58-69. So slight technical error there. And I think both coaches are getting a little bit edgy about it. So hopefully we'll have it sorted out pretty soon.
And how about the Canberra Capitals, Eleanor? Do you think they're absolutely safe in the final four?
Sorry, Darren, I missed that.
The Canberra Capitals, do you think they're absolutely safe in the final four?
Absolutely. The Capitals have a really tough run leading up to the playoffs, which can be a good thing and a bad thing. Good in terms of finals preparation if they do stay in that four, which I'm hoping and pretty sure that they will. But also, you know, they've got quality teams. They've got all of the other top five teams to go up against.
As the referee's timeout being called, so we'll just continue chatting about this, I think, for a moment. And Canberra has a really, before we go into one of the huddles, but Canberra has a really tough weekend. Dandenong and Boleyn in Melbourne.
They do, and it can go either way. If they win both, then they set themselves up.
Well, here's Paul O'Brien with the Perth Links.
Buddy, you're the pressure release down here. Krista, you bust and bust up if they extend it. But if you get a chance to catch on it, we go long. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. What we must do now is we must really lock down defensively. Our matchups are fine, so we just got to keep hustling, switching on screens, keeping our hands up and blocking out, because they will be forced to take bad shots. He's taken Tolo out of the game, so now it's really about Francis. It's about one-on-one getting a stop. But everyone else has got to make sure no one else is a threat. Krista can handle her fine. Everyone else make sure her player doesn't become the next threat to us. Got that? It's getting through offenses, getting put loose.
Well, here's the score bench where all the controversy has been, and the scoreboard is correct now. 69-58, as there's a slight fire, as some of the lights have had to be turned out. There's a slight fire in what appears to be one of the lights.
We knew it was hot in here. It's a good game, but we're talking about the Townsville fire. We're on fire here.
We are indeed. There is the fire. It's thankfully there's nobody underneath that light or whatever it happens to be. So there might be a little bit more of a hold up. And Laurie, I apologise. I cut you off a moment ago. You were talking about Canberra playing Dandenong and Boleyn this week, and a really important weekend for them. And as you say, it's just desperate for them to at least secure one of those wins.
Well, if they win both, it sets them up really well for the finals. In fact, they could look at a top spot depending on results of Adelaide and Sydney. However, if they lose both, well, then they're right in the mix playing off for that fourth spot. So, these last 3 weeks, it's really, really up in the air still. And that makes it exciting for the competition.
Well, it certainly does, and it's a little bit exciting here. We're not quite sure what's going to happen. With 4 minutes 45 remaining, there's 11 points of margin. The Perth Lynx are leading, and there's been a slight fire, and obviously that needs to be checked out. And the fire seems to have gone out. There doesn't appear to be any danger to anyone, but all the lights have been switched off, or most of the lights have been switched off. And Dean Kinsman using this time to have a chat to his charges. The Perth Lynx using this time to just stay warm, doing a little bit of running up and down the court.
It's a really, just under 5 minutes to go. The last thing you want to do is cool down and then have to come out and play and tighten up a little bit and maybe worry about some sort of injuries.
Well, Mark Slocum, our stats man, is just saying that the ex-Perth coach Murray Tresseter was sitting underneath the fire when it actually started. There's a little bit of a smoky smell. It's like living in Melbourne at the moment with all the bushfires, which is...
Well, I think they're going to let them continue the game, which is good.
Well, there was a big fire at the MCG a few years ago that one of the grandstands had to be evacuated. Thankfully, that hasn't happened here, as we're underway again. 4 minutes 45 remaining. 11 points the margin, the Perth Lynx leading.
Oh.
As Nicole Hunt steps up, the break didn't do her any harm whatsoever.
That was great to see her coming off that on-ball screen, coming off as a scorer and recognizing that she can't go all the way to the basket. She's probably going to get blocked. So she did a nice pull-up jumper, a mid-range shot that we like to see.
Here's Wilson with lengthening close attention. 6 seconds on the shot clock. Carr, great position and well worked play. Marino found her with a nice pass.
Zoe Carr cut really hard on that last play and got herself in a position right under the basket to get an easy score.
And Emily for travel. She's frustrated with that.
Carly Wilson actually initiated that travel by coming over and helping.
The 3 minutes 55 remaining. 11 points the margin. The Perth Lynx have led by as much as 15 in the match. Here's Marsh. She's got 11 points. Carly Wilson with 27 points as an offensive foul is called on Marino. She looks frustrated now, but she's been looking frustrated a lot of the night. Nicole Hunt, as you've mentioned a couple of times, Laurie, has worn her like a second skin.
Well, they've had a really interesting battle, and they've gone at it hard, and it's been really good to see.
It's been reminiscent of some of the tagging jobs that Tony Liberatore and some of his mates have been renowned for in the AFL. And good evening to our producer, Tony Fox, of course, a mad Western Bulldog supporter. A lob pass in for Francis, well weighted, but Cayla couldn't get the finish. And the AIS lose the ball from the offensive rebounding position, and Perth Lynx can consolidate their lead once more. Or extend their lead, I should say, with just under 3.5 minutes remaining in this match. There's Hunt. She knew she probably shouldn't have made that play. She just dived at the ball. And it was a little bit ambitious. Yeah. And also a little bit costly too, Laurie, because she's up to four fouls. She's staying in the ball game for the moment though. Wilson, Langford, doing the good defensive work that time. Hunt. Oh, Francis was screaming for it, so was Langford. Unfortunately, AIS just weren't clean enough when they needed to be. Under 3 minutes remaining in the match. At the Perth Lynx still leading by 11.
Good cut off the ball.
But not able to finish. Oh, well played by Hunt. She recognized that Marino had stepped up and she had the presence of mind to step around her as Kate Gaze. That was one of those awkward looking mid-range jumpers, Laurie, you were talking about earlier.
Good follow-up by Tolo. Oh. Sorry, that was Cayla Francis.
18 points and 12 rebounds for Cayla Francis. It's a little bit darker in here at the moment. And,
I'll use that as an excuse.
Yeah,
we'll say it's smoky and dark.
So we apologise if that's coming up on the screen, but we did have that little fire earlier and a lot of the lights have had to be turned out for safety reasons. As Krista Hayes, it's not affecting her vision.
Well, one thing that's good to see is both teams are still going at it hard, even though it's near the end of the game.
And Dean Kinsman still wants to talk about things, even though it is near the end of the game. He still thinks his side's in with a chance, but he was disappointed with those last couple of minutes. 2 minutes remaining, and the AIS have called a timeout. They trail by 11.
In the five spot, Emma, with Mia, you playing that four, no, Beck, you playing the four spot, okay? You're setting the on ball, if I throw it, dive, you come out, on ball slip, straight on the ring, okay?
Straight to end, not off it.
Yeah, yeah, she'll slip, she'll come up, and she'll slip it again, okay? Then we've got to be in hurry up down here. We're on two fouls, so you go on steals on the ball, but go, you're on four, so you can't be as reckless with that, okay? You guys here, you're fresh in, you can get that done for us. But play the ball so you can break it free. Any board that we get out of here, it's caution to the wind, run the floor, when we attack on one side of the floor, you spot up on the opposite. Yeah. On the skips, you got the three. Okay, you got the three or you got the three.
The drug free health message. Sports Medicine Australia plays a role in managing the sponsorship on health.
Well, Deakin's been looking to mix things up over the last couple of minutes and lots of pressures, obviously, the name of the game.
It's good to see that, you know, he's still giving them instructions the last 2 minutes. They probably don't have enough time to win, but, you know, they can still still make a dent in that score.
Well, Eleanor Sharp, how was Paul O'Brien at that last timeout?
Well, Paul's message to the girls was keep up the defensive intensity, but really scramble and talk up the switches if they need to. If they get caught on screens and there's a three-point shooter ready to score, then they really need to switch that up. And offensively, his message was spread the floor, anticipate that the AIS might try and foul them, but stay on the front foot.
Well, 9 points, that's just a couple of threes. You never know.
100 seconds remaining. They're 4 from 15 from beyond the arc, Laurie, so they'll need to get a couple of good looks. Kate Gaze,
good
here's
game.
One.
Got good it! Job!
The AIS have the last 5 points coming out of that timeout. And there's only 6 points the margin, 90 seconds remaining. Another stop here, and the AIS are still in with a major chance.
They don't want to foul now, the Institute.
And they certainly don't want to foul Carly Wilson. But Zoe Carr, great move, might just have sealed the game. As Newley for three, and she got whacked in the face. And she will go to the foul line and shoot three free throws. In fact, only two. The referee said that her foot was on the line,
yep.
And it was. Well, it's a little bit disappointing for the AIS. But at least it didn't take much time off the clock, Laurie, and means that if me and Yuli makes both of these, it's back to that six-point ball game. Missing the first is costly. Missing them both is worse, but Francis, big time. Big time offensive rebound from her. She's got 20 points and 13 rebounds, Cayla Francis.
She's played a massive game today.
And she was a little bit nervous before her pre-game interview as well. Maybe she should be doing interviews every match. Disappointing. Missing free throws at the end of the game is very costly for the AIS.
We look at Perth are shooting at 93% from the 13 from 14.
The AIS down at 55%, including missing their last four. Here's Hayes, 50 seconds remaining. AIS, they'll still play out this game. It's only 8 points the margin. Three-point bomb makes it interesting. Newley tries for that, but it was long, very, very long. 33 seconds remaining, and the Perth Lynx look as though they are safe. Hunt ran into a very strong screen from Hayes. Knocked her around a little bit. Tries to turn Hunt, and nice play from Angela Marino. The keyway was open. She's played a handy game. Francis, quick fire for two. The AIS will get the ball back, but there are only 14 seconds remaining. And the Perth Lynx lead it by 10. Hunt for a long three.
She had to
Nine
take that
to
shot.
Go. Marino threw it up. Will Newley have a go with 3 seconds remaining? Shats for two.
Oh.
That's a nice finish for the AIS. They are disappointed. But the Perth Lynx, 77-69, record a clean sweep over the AIS this season. They've beaten the AIS in all three of their matches. And that was a really tough game, Laurie Chizik.
Well, Well, it is, and as we said from the outcome, from the start of the game, we knew both teams would come out and want to try and secure that win. And they played like they did. They played that whole game. It was very up-tempo, relatively high scoring for these two teams. And it was good to see.
Well, they're certainly both well above their season average, only averaging 61 points a game, both sides. So to register these scores is obviously the coaches would both take positives out of the game.
Well, they would, and it's good for Perth to win their, a home game on their home court. They've got the three wins now over Perth, as she's talked about.
Well, a great win from the Perth Lynx, and would have been very interesting on the stat sheet as well. And Mark Slocum, you've got all of those details.
Thank you very much, Darren. We start off with Perth there. Carly Wilson, 27 points. Her season and career high is 31 this year, but 27 is still her third best effort for the season. So quite good for Carly after, we pointed out at the start of the game, a bit of a form slump. Hayes with 12 and 12. Carr came up big with 12 points. And Marsh with 11, Marino 9. So they're starting five, all having good games. And that, the AIS there, Cayla Francis, 20 points and 13 rebounds. She was great for them. 14 for Tolo. Everyone else really got involved, but no one didn't really have that third scorer to help the big two in Francis and Tolo. And the match stats there, 77 by Perth. That's their highest score of the year. So it came down to scoring, and they managed to score too many for the AIS, 69. Not a bad score for them. They averaged 61. Field goal percent, 46% to 45. Nothing in there, but the free throws were crucial at the end. Perth, 93%. AIS, 55, and they missed those four vital free throws with a minute to go.
Thank you very much, Mark Slocum. Comprehensive as always. Well, now on the sideline, we have our game MVP, and it's no surprise. It's Carly Wilson, and she's with Eleanor Sharp.
Thanks, Darren. Carly, congratulations. That's your third win for the season. You really must be looking forward to that end of season. Tell me about the game.
It feels so good to win. We haven't felt it enough this year, and as you said, third win, so hopefully we can get another one. We've got a bye next weekend, so that gives us a bit of time to rest up for the last game of the season against Dandenong. So if we could get another win for that game, that would be fantastic.
And Carly, just tell me a little bit about your season so far. It's been a big adjustment for you coming from the very successful Dandenong Rangers. But how have you coped with that? You've obviously had to make a lot of changes, and really you have led this team, it's fair to say. Congratulations on that. But what have been the key learning experiences for you?
I think it's been a really tough season, obviously, because as we said before, winning three games, it's going to be tough for any team doing that. But we're in a rebuilding phase, and I think that's been the hardest thing, just everyone learning to play together, and really we're sort of at the beginning of probably another 3 years ahead of us before we're really going to start seeing the improvement. So, although you want the results straight away, it's going to take a few years, and we're definitely on the right track from that. You look at the results and it's three wins, it doesn't really look that good, but you look at some of the games that we've had, and we've had overtime losses, we've had really close losses, so this, the win-loss column doesn't really show how close we've been in some of those games.
A lot of the scoring load has really been put on your shoulders. Does that faze you, or do you just think every game I'm getting out there and I'm getting my 17 and everything else? I mean, you're obviously contributing in other areas, but is that a real focus for you?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and it's a focus for the whole team. We're trying to get me open, and hopefully in doing that, because there is going to be a lot of focus from the other team on me, by trying to get me open, I'm going to get two running to me and we're going to get someone else open and I can just dump it to them. So that's been the plan. Hasn't worked quite so well in some of the games when I'm getting sort of doubled and tripled, and it just makes it really, really difficult. But I knew that was going to be the case coming over here, and I think it's only made me a better player. Although it's been very frustrating, it has really helped me.
Well, congratulations. I really commend you. You've had a wonderful season and some trying times, I'm sure. Just finally, what's your tip? Who is your tip for the big one?
Oh, it's a toughie. I really think at the moment probably Canberra are hitting their straps at the right time.
Yeah!
But I mean, how good is Sydney? Sydney can just turn on whatever they want. And in saying that as well, I know I'm just going to list everyone, so it's not really a good answer at all. But Adelaide, you just can't write them off. They're just so tough, and they've got the inside, they've got the outside game. So between those three teams, I couldn't even tell you. I don't know. It's going to be a very close one.
I agree with you, Carly. Thanks very much, and hope you have a lovely off-season. Finish out the season and have a lovely rest.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to Carly Wilson and Eleanor Sharp as we see some of Carly's highlights from tonight, and there were plenty of them, Laurie.
Well, they were. She just dominated the game and right really from the onset. So we can see that every time she got the ball, she was ready to shoot it. And as she mentioned, you know, the pressure's on her, but the team is trying to set her up, trying to get the ball in her hands, and I thought they did a good job of that tonight.
From a coach's perspective, how tough is it when you actually you know that your star player is going to get that difficult treatment, and you know you have to plan around it, but maybe you don't have the options?
Well, it's not so much you know, forcing her to get shots. It's about the rest of the team recognizing if she is double and triple team that they've got to do something else. They've got to get themselves in the open and help her out and be ready to receive her passes.
And do you think that's one of the things that Paul O'Brien, when he's looking to recruit players for next year, he's going to have to look for is another offensive weapon to take some pressure off Carly?
Well, Carly talked about the rebuilding phase that this team's going to, and it would be really nice if they could keep a core group of these players rather than, you know, turning players over every year. If they can keep a core group here and bring some other players to assist the Carly Wilsons, the Zoe Cars, if they decide to stay, then you take that next step.
Well, Laurie, one of the coaches from tonight's game, not Paul O'Brien, Dean Kinsman, has a slightly different philosophy and a slightly different, I guess, brief as well when he's coaching the AIS, and he's now with Eleanor Sharp.
Thanks, Darren. Dean, commiserations on that. I thought you guys might have really got over the line towards the end there, but what would you say has been the most improvements for the girls so far this season?
I think the most significant thing is that we're starting to learn how to play longer, maturer minutes on the floor. We're making some better decisions on better offensive execution at times. Some of the things that are happening for us inside, down into the isolations, high-low action for us with Cayla and Tolo in particular, is really good for us. And we feel encouraged about that, and we feel that we're on the right track, and we just got to get a little bit more from our perimeter game, take a bit of pressure off those two guys, and you know, I think we're going to be in good shape.
It was evident that the girls are really stringing together some mature phases of play. I mean, some of those plays weren't happening just by accident. There was real thought process there, which I think, you know, from your point of view, must be encouraging.
Yeah, look, their understanding of the game is improving. I think a few things are starting to drop for them. Our experience of going to the States and obviously playing in the league like this against some quality people. I just think over time, we'd like the season to go another 10 games or more for us so that we could continue to keep building on that. But you're right. Look, we are starting to do some things out on the floor, and it's noticeable, and it is encouraging.
And this week, I believe that there's an Australia regional camp for the girls. Will most of the girls be participating in that camp?
Yeah, look, it's actually the week after. We've got a double road trip next week, and all of the girls here will be into the camp next week. The week after. And that's our junior camp for our selections for the World Championships.
Well, good luck, Dean, for the rest of the season. You might get another win, I'm hopeful.
Well, you never know. Like, we play well enough against other teams and some of the better teams, and it's just a matter of trying to get extended minutes, and who knows?
Well, good luck.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much to Dean and Eleanor, of course, there. And Laurie, you've coached a lot of basketball in your time. Must be tough to coach the AIS.
Well, I thought Dean Kinsman was really spot on with his comments that he made about them maturing. They're some of the things now are starting to happen for them. So that's really good to see. And whilst it's frustrating, they don't measure the wins and losses. They look at a lot of other different things. And I think he'd be really pleased with their performance.
We certainly would be on tonight's performance as well. Well, now we're going to cross back right back to Eleanor Sharp. And she's got one of the legends of the Perth Basketball Club, Melissa McClure.
Thanks, Darren. Yes, she certainly is one of the legends of the Perth Lynx Basketball Club, Melissa McClure, and she now has a new role, and that's as mum. Mel, how's motherhood treating you?
It's great at the moment. As you can see, she's fast asleep, so hopefully she'll stay like that till at least 6 o'clock in the morning, and we'll wait and see then as to how she reacts for the rest of the day.
And she, of course, is Hannah.
Yes, that's right. Hannah Lynn Sinfield, and she's four months old now, and she's still only little, but we're getting there and getting her bigger and bigger every week.
Now, the question that everyone seems to ask me, but I'm not sure whether you get it that often, but do you feel itchy feet and do you want to get back on the court?
It's good to watch the girls get a win tonight. I think they played really well together as a team, and I think that's, you know, if they had have done that maybe in a couple of other matches throughout the season, they would have got a few more wins. But no, I'm quite happy sitting on the sidelines watching and being a mother, and hopefully, you know, now that the singlet's retired, I definitely won't be getting back out on the court.
Well, thanks, Mel, for taking some time to talk to us tonight, and hope to see you around at more games in the future.
Anything for you, Elle. Thank you.
Thanks, Mel.
Oh, Eleanor Sharp again, just doing all her best work after the game. She's a star. And it's great to see the former, the past players and the past champions still coming back and being involved.
Well, it is, and it's Sharpie so can talk to them so naturally, and it's, yeah, it's great to see the likes of past players coming out and supporting.
For joining us in Perth tonight, the Lynx running out comfortable victors in the end over the AIS. Thanks to Laurie Chiswick, Eleanor Sharp and Mark Slocum. We look forward to bringing you more WNBL action next week.